I think having this on the chin here is probably good enough. Is that okay? Or should it be further? All right, I think this is the first time I've given a keynote address while sitting down, but it feels like we're in the living room just having a conversation, so I think that's good. Hello everyone, I just got into Bangalore last night. So far I've enjoyed it, mostly spent most of my time in traffic or in bed. And as introduced, I'm going to be talking about solving the two-language problem in data science, but that's not quite right. I'm going to be talking about solving the four-language problem in data science. And what four-language problem is this? You may not have any idea what I'm talking about. The two-language problem, the four-language problem, you certainly don't know. And I'm actually thinking of a very specific problem that I had at one point. Back, in 2009, I was still in grad school. I was a data scientist, although I didn't realize it because it was 2009, and the term data scientist hadn't really taken off yet. That was I did a Google Trends search earlier today, and I verified this, that in 2009, there was very little talk about data scientists. But I had this stack that I was doing a project, and in this one project, I was using MATLAB for numerical linear algebra. That seems pretty reasonable. But I was also using R for statistical analysis. So I would do some, run some experiments with matrices, and then I'd collect some data about them. But doing statistical analysis in MATLAB is just very painful. So I'd export the data in CSV and then load it into R, and then do the statistical analysis and visualization in R. Okay, so far not terrible, two systems. But then some of the stuff had to be very fast. And I couldn't get it to be fast enough in either of these other two languages. So I ended up using C for that. So there's C code in there too. And then, because you're loading in data and saving data, you're producing these CSV files and all this stuff, shuffling that around in any of these languages is terrible. You don't want to write that code in C or in R or in MATLAB. So I had Ruby files to sort of handle all of that. And at some point, you step back at this and you look at it and you're like, what have I created? This is a monstrosity. I don't know if anyone here is familiar with Rube Goldberg. He was this illustrator who was pretty famous in the U.S. They even made a stamp of sort of honoring him at some point in the 90s. You make these contraptions where they sort of like one thing hits another, which eventually accomplishes something useful. And that was exactly what this was like. So all these pieces coming together. I was actually generating R and C and MATLAB code from inside of Ruby. Total nightmare. So from my perspective, this very much was my motivation for Julia. I was like, we have to be able to do something better. And I was hanging out with Raul one day and complaining about this, and he said, you know what? There's this guy, Jeff, that you absolutely have to talk to. We've been talking about this for years. And we think we can do better and we should do better. And so the three of us started talking on email about that and decided to try to do something. And Julia is what came to that. I have a confession to make, which is I've actually done worse than this. I've done up to 6 or 7 programming languages in one project. And there's always some justification for every single one, but it's a terrible confession to have to make. So what is the two-language problem in the first place? This is a term that people may not be familiar with. There's this other thing that may be more familiar, maybe not. It's called Oosterholt's dichotomy. It's named after this guy, John Oosterholt, who is actually the creator of Tickle. We can blame him for that. But he observed that there was this sort of division between in programming languages that seemed to be happening. I think he observed this at some time point in the 80s. And he noticed that there are systems languages and there are scripting languages. And the world seems to be divided this way. And systems languages are static, scripting languages are dynamic. The systems languages are compiled, scripting languages are interpreted. System languages let you the user define their own types. The scripting languages have standard types. They just have sort of arrays and strings and dicts, and that's it. You don't define new types. You maybe can define classes, but I think even back then the idea of having classes in scripting languages hadn't really become much of a thing. And systems languages programs tend to be pretty standalone. you create an executable, run it, it does its thing, takes input, produces output. Scripting languages are often used as glue. They connect lots of other pieces together. And so this, you know, at the time was a pretty clear divide. There were a lot of examples of this, and it seemed like there were just these two different worlds. And so why is this a problem, right? This is an observation, it's not really a problem. And so the problem comes in that because of this dichotomy, we end up typically doing a two-tier compromise. And so that is for convenience, because writing in these, you know, systems languages is usually a little bit difficult. There's a lot of extra typing, you know, they're kind of verbose. So we use a high-level dynamic language that falls very much into that scripting language category. It has all of those properties, it's dynamic, it's interpreted, etc. We use that for convenience, but then we end up doing all of the hard stuff in a systems language. So all of the actual work gets done in C or C++ or Fortran, and then all you really do is use this high-level language like MATLAB or R or Python to tie it all together. And this is actually pretty good. It works well. I've written many systems where, you know, I write the part that has to be fast in C, and I make it a Ruby extension or something like that. And then I actually play around with it and build all the high-level logic in Ruby. It's a pretty good design. It's actually really practical. So what's the problem? It has some issues. So the first one is, it's the hard parts that you would really benefit from having an easier language for, right? So if, you know, if all you're doing is the easy stuff in the easy language, that's fine if all you have to do is the easy stuff. But when you're the person who actually is implementing whatever numerical algorithm or data analysis or whatever, if you have to do it in C because it has to be fast, now you're not benefiting from this convenience. You're not benefiting from the ease of use that this other language is supposed to give you. So it's really only the end users who get the benefit, which is unfortunate. It tends to force vectorization if you want performance. I mean, anybody who's written MATLAB or R code is familiar with, you know, don't use a for loop. Like, God forbid you use a for loop. This is a terrible idea, because it will be very slow. And that can sometimes be very nice and convenient. You can write these very tiny one-line expressions that can do a lot of stuff and are pretty efficient. But sometimes it's awkward. Sometimes you really wish you could just use a for loop. Other times it's wasteful because you end up allocating a lot of memory for temporary arrays. So finally, this I didn't realize at first. When we started this project, I had no idea what a big deal this was going to be. This separation of two levels creates a real social barrier. It makes a big wall between users and developers. So the developers live in the low-level language, and the users live in the high-level language. And if you're a user and you hit, you know, you're trying to figure out what's going on, maybe there's a bug, maybe you're just confused about how something works, you can step through, you know, let's say some MATLAB code or some R code or Python code, but then as soon as you hit, well, if you hit the, you know, the built-in wall in MATLAB, you're stuck because you don't get to see the MATLAB code. It's proprietary. But, you know, in R and Python, you could go look at the C code. I program in C all the time, so in theory, I could do that. I've never done it. Because once you hit that wall, once you hit the C library, you're just like, I can't be bothered. It's too much difficulty. So if you take away that barrier, you can tear down the difference between the user and developer, and then your users automatically kind of become developers over time. So this is that dichotomy again. And so what Julia lets us do is it lets us tear it down. That was supposed to be a build. I totally worked on that. That was very, very upsetting. But yeah, so Julia takes, you know, it's dynamic and it's compiled, which is one item from one column and one item from the other. It lets you users define their own types, but it also provides you with all the convenient standard types like arrays and dicts and you know, whatever else you're used to from your dynamic programming language. It's a nice string type. You can produce standalone programs or use it as glue. Another way to look at this also that I'm fond of is this. Is that it puts us in a unique position in terms of speed versus productivity, right? So this graph is it's sort of an aggregate over some benchmarks, where the the score of a language on a benchmark is what its time, how long it takes relative to C, assuming that C is about as good as it gets. And you can see that C is on here, it's on this list of languages, and it's at exactly one. So C is as good as itself in terms of performance. And then normalized lines of code, I think that's how many lines of code normalized so that it's, I don't remember how the normalization is done, but so that this number kind of makes some sense. Essentially what it says is that from zero is the smallest number of lines of code per benchmark, and one is the most number of lines of code per benchmark. So this is a little weird because JavaScript looks really verbose here, and this is actually because in JavaScript we had to implement our own matrix multiply. So it's a little bit of a cheat. JavaScript isn't really that verbose, but you can see that Fortran is very far to the right, C is very far to the right, Java is slightly less far to the right, but still you tend to write a lot of code. And then in terms of being very concise, you have other things like Lua, I think, is pretty far left. Oh no, that's R. R is actually that purple thing over there. But so some of these high level languages. So essentially, we have here these are the systems languages, and these are the scripting languages. And what you want is you want to be in the corner. You'd like to be in the corner for between both of those, and that's exactly where Julia is. So I think that's really satisfying. That's kind of the whole pitch that you can aggregate Neeta to. Okay, so let's look at that Rube Goldberg data science stack. So today I use Julia for numerical linear algebra instead of MATLAB. I use Julia for statistical analysis instead of R. I use Julia for the fast stuff too, and I use Julia to tie it all together. So now we've eliminated this four language problem. A lot of this you could also be done with Python. So Python has been growing very popular in terms of data analysis. But one thing you can't really get is you can't get rid of the C for the fast stuff. So you can get it down. You can get it down to a two language problem, but you can't get it down to a one language problem with Python. There are systems like Cython, but I think that's a little bit cheating because Cython is not really Python. It's Python. That Python and C had a weird love child. And I don't really like it. Some people really like it. I find it very confusing every time I look at it, but it's a teach its own. I like having one language that is truly just one language that I can do all of these things in. So people are going to talk about some statistical analysis, some visualization, some machine learning and numerical linear algebra later on today. So I'm going to focus on this last item, how Julia lets you tie all these things together, how it acts as sort of a Ruby or Wakefile or Python replacement. Okay, so what does it mean to tie things together? So one of the natural things you have to do is you need to read, parse, and write files. That's, you can't live without that. To get to the computation, you need to have done all of this grunt work just to get there, and then you have to write it out again. Running external commands, this is huge. Sometimes you want to call a Unix command. All you want to do is call find or sort or something like that. You need to do networking. You need to talk. You need to pull stuff off of the network, and you need to also be able to serve things up to people. And you also want to be able to call other programming languages. So, just by way of example, you would not generally, if you're a sane person, consider writing a web server in MATLAB or in R. I believe people have actually written web servers in R, but it seems crazy. In Python, it's totally reasonable. So that again is another place. Python is a general purpose language, which just sort of has the numerical stuff grafted onto it. So it's very different from these other numerically oriented languages. Okay, so now let's see some code. Let's see, it's 9:55. What time are we on?
still have 15 minutes.
I got 15 minutes. Okay, perfect. That's great. Okay. So now I'm going to turn the mirroring off. Okay, so we start up Julia. Let's see. The first thing we might want to do is download a file. Okay, so there's a handy download command. I have this in my history. This guy, Jared Lander, who's actually a friend of mine, he lives in New York, does a lot of our work. Somehow we managed to be friends anyway. He even helped me run the Julia NYC meetup. He's very pro Julia. But he still does all this stuff in R. So we can download this housing data, which if it's too slow, I have a copy, so I'm just gonna not download it. But oh yeah, it's pretty quick. Okay. And so we can see I just switched into a shell mode. People may or may not be familiar with this, but if you hit semicolon at the beginning of a line, you get a shell mode, and then you can just type shell init. So we can, look at the top of this, and what we can see is that this is actually it's a CSV file with a lot of data about housing prices and various other things in New York. So let's load it. So there's this read CSV command. Read CSV. Okay, yeah. So we get it as an any array. It's just got a bunch of junk in it. All strings. If we look at some of these, let's just call it any. Shell type it a lot, so it'll be easier. So those are all integers, but it actually ends up being an any typed array because it includes that first thing. We really like these to just be straight up integers. This is kind of awkward. So, well, it turns out there's a whole package for dealing with this kind of data frames. And you'll note that loading that, if you were on version 0.3, is painfully slow. On 0.4, it's so quick. It's so nice. This is because we can pre-compile and cache packages that we've already loaded before, which is a really huge blessing. So instead of doing read CSV, we just change this to read table. And now we have something that's a little nicer. So we can do H:5, and we see that that's actually a data array of ints. We can do much more stuff with that. It's a lot easier. I'm not going to spend time actually analyzing this data set. I just wanted to show how you can download things and then read them. So, let's say I wanted to. I kind of thought this was fun. Here's an example where. That shows the kind of thing that you can do. You can do this in Python, you can do it in Ruby, you can do it in Perl. I actually think it's nicer and easier to do this kind of thing in Julia than in any of these other languages. So here's an example. That's a little fancier than I wanted. What this shows you is that you can open a command. So in Julia, let me start with the other thing. So if you want to run an external command, this is pretty straightforward. So in other programming languages, the backticks will just actually execute the command. And I had a friend who I was working with who writes a lot of Ruby code, and he's one of the most productive programmers I know. But he also does these things that drive me crazy, because if you put everything in backticks, what it actually means is take the output of this, in Ruby anyway, take the output of this script and save it into a variable. But you just use this to run stuff and do it everywhere, and I'd like sort of twitch a little every time I saw his code, but it didn't matter, it worked. It worked until it didn't work. There was like some subtle bug because he was like splicing a variable and then there was a file name with space in it and then the whole thing breaks. But watching him, I it would bother me. I would get that little twitch every time I saw him do something that I knew was technically incorrect. But I was also like, why is he wrong? He's not wrong. The programming language should actually make what he wants to do right. Instead of, you know, giving him a hard time and just being like, no, don't do it that way. Do it this other way that's much more difficult. I said, okay, well, I was at the time developing Julian on the side. I was one of these crazy people who had his own programming language because it was 2010 and nobody had ever heard of it. The way he used the backticks in Ruby inspired me to try to do this better in Julian. So let me show you some of the examples. So, take the first, three lines of that admin file. So we have the command, and we actually just want to run that. Okay, so we get it. That's cool. Now let's say we wanted to actually cut out a couple of columns using Unix tools. But we can do a pipeline, which dcomrun-f1,2, we'll do it. We'll see. Nope, sorry. Okay, so there you go. So 1,2, maybe 3,4. Okay, so now we're using Unix tools to cut out a little tiny slice of this thing. So what's going on here? Pipeline is constructing a pipeline between these different things. The same way that you would use a pipe character in Unix, and then runs the resulting thing. And you can see that if we don't run it, we just get an object that represents that pipeline. And it sets it the standard out to be this other file. But we can run it. Now, the reason I didn't want the backticks to just give to run the thing is because a lot of times what you want to do is something else. You might want to do something like read it. Instead of printing the data, I want to capture it in the string. So the idea was you have this object that represents the thing you want to do, and then you actually can read from it. So of course, you don't typically have a fixed file that you want to read. You have some, file name that you want to splice in there. That's not going to work because files are defined, but let's say we do temp-housing.csv. Okay, and now that works. It does the thing we wanted. Let's just run it. Okay. Let's say we move that temp file to temp-housing with spaces. Oops. Okay, so now we can see that in the terminal, if we cap this with the appropriate coding, we do get the file. But this obviously isn't going to work because now the file doesn't exist. So let's try changing this. Housing with spaces. Now this works. Why does this work? This is a really good question. This would totally break if we were doing it in Ruby or Perl or something like that. And the reason is because if you take a look at what happens with this object when we actually interpolate that, it quotes it for you. What is going on? Is this magic? So what's actually happening is that this backtack syntax, the easiest way to think about it is it's actually a very strange array syntax. It's actually a syntax for array literals. So if you take this thing, it actually has a field called exec, which is the array of things that actually is going to get called by the passed to the exec system call. And what that means is that we're actually never calling a shell. We don't do the whole thing where you pass them up to a shell which does all of the work and actually constructs the pipeline for you. Because the problem is then you have to sort of work around all the things that the shell thinks is special. So instead, the mantra here is don't use a shell, be a shell. So the idea is that Julia implements all of the things that your shell implements with sort of similar syntax. And that way, it knows about things like, well, okay, file is actually it actually just takes the file object and puts it in there as the third argument, because it knows that that's what's supposed to happen. I was talking about how this backtick syntax is really sort of like a strange array syntax. And that might make sense, right? Because shell commands are, like, the shell splits your thing on spaces, and then it's an array of arguments. That's exactly what the shell is all about. It's about sort of figuring out what the array of things to call exec on is. That's pretty much all the shell does for you. It calls exec and dupe and a bunch of other system calls in a particular finicky order and lets you have a nice syntax to that. So we do the same thing. So let's say I want to define multiple files. So file A, and I wanted to handle all of those in here. Well, if you just type files in, you get exactly what you want. And you can see that what this does is it actually, it knows because it's in the programming language. So the reason the shell splits on spaces is because it has no array data structure. Now the shells do, but back when shells were first invented, they just had strings and all they had. And so you're like, okay, well, how do we simulate an array that only has strings? Split on spaces. Perfect. Solves the problem. Except for then you have arguments that might have spaces, and then, et cetera. It just becomes a rabbit hole that you disappear down. Well, so we're not in that situation. We're in a real programming language that has arrays and has strings, and strings can have spaces in them. So why would we collapse something into a spruce string only to then have the problem of figuring out how to turn it back into an array? So instead we just take the array and pass it all the way through, and that's exactly what happens here. There's some niceties that the shell gives you, like, for example, if you have, you can do things in an array like, foo, bar, baz, and the curly brace syntax, and it'll expand it into three different versions. But we do a very similar thing if you take the file, it works as you would expect. It just appends txt to that one argument. But with files, it actually does that to each of them. So that's kind of nice. It goes through. You can expand with like a literal thing here. So txt, exe, you can save yourself a bunch of typing. You get all of the file combinations. And they're correctly quoted, so you don't have to worry about that. This correct quoting thing seems minimal, but it actually is the difference between it being kind of fragile and unreliable to call external commands and being completely reliable and a robust thing that you don't worry about. So a good example of this. So let's say my data is the string backslash r, backslash t, backslash n, backslash v, backslash a, backslash 01, x01. Okay, so this is an awful, very, full of escape characters bit of data. If you wanted to try to pass this as an argument to echo, for example, or some other command, total nightmare in the shell. I don't even know how you do this. It is probably doable, but you probably have to assign something. I don't know. I've tried it before, and it becomes kind of difficult. But here, we try it, and, okay, well, there's some horrible string in there. But you see, the key is that underneath it all, it actually just has that string. So it knows exactly, it has at no point tried to interpret anything. And so what that means is that as soon as we call read all on this, so read all runs the command and it collects all of its output and gives you a string, we get the exact thing back. So is this equal to data? Yeah, it's exactly data. And in fact, there's only one exception. Any crazy binary data you want to pass through this way, it'll go through. And the one exception is, say data is equal to, so let's put a null byte in there, a 0 byte, and let's see what happens. Okay, So now what happens is, this actually used to just, it would just fail, but now we're more careful about how we pass things to C. And what actually happens here is that it detects that the string has an embedded null, and if you try to pass that through the spawn process, it will, because the process actually, you know, when you write a C program, for example, right, you get the arguments and the way their null terminated. So you couldn't possibly get any data beyond the null. So now we actually cache that and warn you about it. So you can't do that, but at least you get a proper warning instead of just unexpected behavior. So the example I wanted to show with open was this. So what this does is it starts the sort command in write mode. So that says I would like to write data to the sort command, and then it says this do syntax is a way of passing an anonymous function, basically with an argument. It's IO. And then what I'd like to do is I'm gonna print in Julia code a random permutation of the numbers 1 through 10, and then that's going to go to the sort command. And we can, well, let's use print to the cat command so we can see that it just comes out exactly in some random order. You know, we don't know the order because it's random. But if we sort them, it'll come out in a particular order. Not quite the order we want it, right? Because sorts things as strings. So 10 comes right after 1. But we can also tell sort to do numerical sorting in the right order. We can do things like reverse it. That'll also work. Reverse it. Not as numbers, etc. So anyway, the bottom line is just that Julie is very good at this sort of thing. Let's see. I feel like I should show writing a very simple web server. So Mux is a web server. It's pretty basic. So here is something I ran earlier, which basically sets up a test app using Mux that does some very simple things. It sets up for root just to respond with hello world. It sets up an about page, which either responds about me or boo, and then it sets up a bunch of routes to users, where it just says hello and then your username. And it's got 404 otherwise. And then you just this see what this guy is. Test is a Mux app, and then there's some anonymous function inside there, which is what it actually does. And you can just serve this. Okay. So it's listening on localhost. And we can open up a window. Oh my god, that's gonna be tiny. I can't make the URL bar much bigger, but at least the text will be bigger. And we can see that it's thinking. And it does hello world. And you also can see that it was running some code and it encountered a warning, so we know it's actually doing something. It's silent otherwise. If we go to the about page, it says about me. Maybe 1 in 10? Ah, 1 in 10 times it goes through. I almost spelled it wrong. See not found, and then you can see user 123 says hello 123. We don't do any validation here. This can be a string. There's no app probably one ID and stuff, but there's no database connected to this, so it's not like it's a user ID or anything. So it's easy to do this. This is not, you know, I would say at this point if you're wanting to write a full blown web app, we do not have the infrastructure for that. You're better off using something like Django and maybe offloading, calling Julia to do the compute part. But I think that might not be the case for too much longer. I feel like, you know, putting together a reasonable web web framework should be possible. I think it probably doesn't ever need to be as complicated as Rails or Rails. Let's try actually making a request from Julia, because that's the other thing. Obviously, you know, okay, so we have a web server, can we actually do a web client as well? So we can do requests dot get HTTP localhost 8000. Okay, so we got. Okay, so we got this request object. It's kind of opaque, it doesn't tell us much, but if we look at the data, it's got some data, which, oops, is just bytes. That's actually not very helpful. But we can always wrap some bytes in a UTF-8 string object, and then it'll actually print it as a string, and we can see that that is hello world. And that's what we're serving to the web browser. All right. So some interesting things. Just so it's actually interesting and it has some delay, I'm going to request my home page, which is hosted on GitHub, so that'll take a little bit of time. Hopefully not too much time, but it should take a little bit of time. So the network is now. Oh, okay. All right. Well, then I better stick with local stuff. I was hoping to show some sort of scaling, but it's not going to work very well. You time this, and then you can do, for example, let's say, user ID, ID equals 1 through 1,000. Let's say you're, you know, trying to make requests for a lot of users. Let's do 100. Okay, so we can see that that is about 10 times slower than you're doing one. Yeah, that's more than that. It's better than 10 times slower, but it's, you know, it's scaling terribly well. But if you can, for example, using async IO in Julia. So the way IO works in Julia is, well, so what we want is we want the usability of writing blocking IO without the performance problems. So essentially what we do is we wrap libuv in a blocking API, but every time you do a blocking call, it actually just says to the scheduler, okay, make this task stop and not do anything until it has something that it's supposed to do. And then we allow you to add many tasks. So for example, if you were writing a web server that you wanted to serve lots of concurrent tasks and not block on one and fail to serve all the others, all you do is you create a task for each of those connections, and you let them each do their own independent thing, and the scheduler goes back and forth between them. There's pretty easy macros to let this to work with this sort of thing. So the sync macro makes sure that a bunch of different tasks that are all executing wait for each other and connect back at the end. And the async macro says do this thing asynchronously in its own thread. So what this is doing now is going to spawn a new task for each request so that they don't block each other and they don't have to happen in sequence. They can happen concurrently. And then before the for loop exits, wait for all of them to have finished and joined. And so that is a bit faster. It doesn't scale that well because it's long localhost. When I was doing this on a 2-0 remote machine, you got, you know, much better scaling where it was like, you know, 10 times faster to do it in parallel than in sequence. So this, if anybody's familiar with, uh, so So this is these tasks are also known as coroutines. This is the same model that other languages like Erlang has this model. Go has a pretty similar model, except Go actually takes it one step further and has threads behind this. And we're actually going to move to that model in the future. We're working on experimental writing as a feature in the language. So let's take some questions.
Yes. One day question on the previous screen you had colon and then the variable name.
Yes.
Is that a part of the language or is this part of that particular library?
You mean in?
No, not that, not this one.
Oh, yes.
Colon user, colon params.
That is actually just. So parts of it are and parts of it aren't. So this colon user in here is just part of a string. That's just normal text. This here is an expression interpolated into a string. So between these parentheses is actual Julia code. And these are, the colon params is a symbol. So it's sort of, it's like if you're in Ruby, symbols are like this too. So params is a symbol. You can see the type of it. Simple. It's sort of conventional to use that as keys if you just have a name.
That's a Ruby symbol.
So it's very much like Ruby. If you're familiar with Lisp, this would be params. It's sort of the same thing. So, yeah.
So if I have multiple concurrent processes or threads, right? I want only concurrency, not parallelism.
Right, so we call them tasks, not threads specifically, because they're not actually, you can express that they're concurrent, but they won't be parallel.
Okay.
So they won't run at the same time. They'll always run, only one will be running at a particular time, but you express the fact that I would like you to go let them do work.
But how does that compare to a thread on Linux? Which Linux handles on itself? Or a C thread?
So C threads can actually work at the same time, which is both good and bad. It means that you have to worry about them having that, having race conditions, various other issues. But that is what we're working on having thread support. At which point, the way Go sort of deals with the fact that you might have race conditions is that they encourage you can actually write to the same mutable memory and totally make a mess of things, but they encourage you to communicate between threads using channels. And there is actually a channel abstraction.
So that's what you need to do now also, right? For your concurrent tasks?
Yes.
In Julia also.
Yeah, you can communicate between tasks with channels. You can actually also communicate across different machines with channels, which is something Go does not let you do, but Erlang does.
Okay, so once you move to the threading model, would concurrent tasks be lighter than threads, and would that be faster, or?
So the model that has been sort of, everybody's kind of converged on is the light model for getting the best performance out of threading, is that you have only about as many physical threads, kernel threads, as you have physical cores. Because otherwise swapping in and out with kernel threads, having 10,000 kernel threads when you only have 32 cores is just a lot of overhead and a lot of time. Swapping in anything in and out of the kernel is very slow. So what you'd like to do is you want to express your work in terms of small tasks, so units of concurrency, and then let the scheduler decide what thread to execute them on. And it has a pool of threads that are just approximately on the order of the number of physical cores you have. And that way you get the best performance. That's exactly what Go does. That's, I think, what Erlang does. It's generally the best way.
So you're saying that the tasks are multiplexed one thread now, but if you take like one.
Yeah, we only have all the Julia code executes in one thread currently.
So what's the ballpark? How many tasks can I have at the same time? Erlang would take it to like a million actors.
Yeah, we're definitely not as. We're not as scalable as Erlang yet.
To paraphrase this question, right? Like, I can write a very bad implementation of task and it might be slower than that.
Right.
If I write a good at one point, it's going to be better than that. So, in case of Julia, is that approximate data?
this Shashi emitter timer in my focus.
I mean, you have hundreds of thousands. You can have a million tasks. Tasks are very lightweight.
The question is, it's an implementation.
But we can actually do it. You've tried making a million tasks and it works. Okay. Great. Awesome. A million.
Awesome.
I don't personally have that much cause to create.
You can just try it out.
But should I write some code that does this?
I think Steve.
Okay. That's a good idea. So I'm at four. Let's try like 10,000.
Thanks for showing them at least.
Okay, so 10,000 tasks. It only took 1 second, which is what we were hoping for. So let's go for a million. Let's do it. Into the six. That's not terrible. I mean, it worked. this is actually a pretty neat machine. This is one of these new MacBooks, which is great for traveling and terrible for compiling Julia. Takes like 10% of my battery to recompile Julia and run all the tests.
Like 1 gigahertz or something.
Yeah, it's pretty slow. Any other questions? Okay, great. Thank you very much.